yourselves and in your line of work, especially as it relates to identity. Just start anywhere.
Okay. My name is Othman. I'm a longtime member of the community here. I'm an attorney by training. Worked with many Islamic organizations, and consider myself to be a Muslim activist.
I'm Kristin Hansen. I'm the Director of Development for the ACLU of Wisconsin Foundation. And as you can imagine, we have been a little busy lately. A lot of the themes that ran through this play really resonated with me for a lot of reasons.
Hi, my name is Andy Nunemaker. I have a software company here in town called Dynamis. Also identify with the LGBTQ community.
My name is Rick Esenberg. I am President and General Counsel of the Wisconsin Institute for Law and Liberty, a legal organization and think tank dedicated to, I suppose, as it's pertinent here, individual liberty and freedom of speech.
My name is Paula Penebaker. I am President CEO of YWCA Southeast Wisconsin, an organization whose mission is eliminating racism and empowering women, promoting peace, justice, freedom, and dignity for all. I identify as an African American woman.
Let's hear for our panel. Well, much to talk about, I'm sure. If you've been following the news, there was a big event that happened yesterday. And today as well, many marches planned and executed around the world, really. So before we get into the theme of today's panel discussion, which is identity politics, let's just take a moment to focus on identity first, just to kind of, let's start there and bridge into the politics part. So, you know, this performance tonight, obviously, so many different themes of identity. Some really overt and some more subtle. So I'm just kind of curious from each of your perspectives, based on your work, what were some of the most resounding themes of identity that came through?
There was a lot. I mean, there's a lot of layers in this play. I loved it. But I think from my perspective, growing up as an African-American person before that expression was coined, I'm old enough to have lived in a time when black people were colored. And looking as I do, identity in the black community is very much tied, at least in my experience, was very much tied to what color on the spectrum you fell as a black person. So I think how we define ourselves is often not within our control. And I think that was some of the subtlety that I experienced in the production.
You know, so my own view, and you know, I would be probably seen as a critic of the notion of identity politics and concerned about the dangers. It seems to me that one has to be realistic about the experience that people that you're interacting with have, and then yet realize that at some point it's important for us to treat everyone we interact with as an individual and to transcend that. It seemed to me that what happened in the play is they got into trouble when they sort of, when the conflict began, and what they did is they hid behind their tribal identities and really stopped seeing each other as the individual human beings and friends that they were.
Yeah, there was an element of, I mean, throughout this, like what you said, kind of, you can't control your identity. It's baked into who you are. But yet we saw Amir, our lead character, do everything to try to break away from how he began and how he was raised and lived his life completely contrary to his upbringing. So you know, that's something that you know transcends Islam. It can apply to any kind of identity.
Well, I agree. And the thing that resonated with me is he almost had felt that his identity was a source of embarrassment rather than a source of pride, and then the pride tried to come out. And I see members of different communities, and there are some members that are hiding who they are. There are members who are afraid to identify with what they are or who they are because of the reaction that they perceive from the rest of society. I mean, to me, raising this type of an awareness of understanding what's really going on inside someone and what might be going on in a relationship really hammers home the point you can't judge until you're in that skin. You can't judge a relationship unless you're in it. You can't judge a person until you're actually in their skin, which really means you can't judge anybody. And if we can evolve into a world that's more compassionate and understanding of who we all really are, the world would be a better place. I think there's a fear that the world is going in the wrong direction.
I don't like the term identity politics, because to me it seems to mean that you're supposed to pick one. What is your one identity, and what are you going to do with that politically? I prefer to think of it as personal politics, or because what I really think it's about is vulnerability and fear of what that vulnerability that you have will generate as far as discrimination goes. So in this play, what I was seeing was Amir deciding that his Muslimism was the vulnerability that he had to figure out how to protect himself from. He couldn't change his appearance, so he changed his name. And was going
to, behaviors,
and his behaviors, right. And perhaps whether or not he was, you know, deciding for real to leave Islam, or whether that was part of this transformation, he wanted to blend in order to further his legal career.
Yeah, I'm thinking of that.
And it obviously backfired big time. But that was, I think that's one of the issues we're having, is that trying to pick a thing and saying, I'm going to identify as a woman or a black woman or a white man is not enough. And we're trying to check boxes so that it makes it easier for the demographers and pollsters to figure out what we're all thinking. And it's way more than one box that we're all thinking. It's whatever is your vulnerability that you're worried about at the time. And it might be your legal status, it might be a color, it might be a sexual orientation, it might be a job situation. And I think we saw that happen last year. A lot of the identities or personal politics was not actually about a physical trait, but about someone's economic situation.
Well, it shows you too how broad just the term identity is.
Right.
You know, when we were first discussing this subject matter, when I was first meeting with folks here at the Rep about moderating this panel, I was kind of thinking the same thing about identity. You know, what identity do I really bring to this discussion as a white male? You know, but there are so many more layers. You know, I also, like Andy, I identify in the LGBT community, and you know that is something. And just being a white male, that is something too. You know, but I see what you're saying about limiting it to just I'm a white male and that's it. And that's, you know, that can go
or
for any identity.
Or you're a member of the LGBT and that's it.
Right.
That's
right.
Not enough.
So let me ask you, as you know, as a Muslim activist, is this something that you know, some of the angst that we heard in the play, is this something that you're feeling from the people that you deal with, that, you know, in your past as an activist?
I mean, we've discussed this play among members of the Muslim community, and I think the concern is that it's really reinforcing some of the most prevalent and I would say tired stereotypes, whether current or historical stereotypes, Orientalist stereotypes of Muslims. And a bigger concern is that here's Amir who decided to call himself a non-Muslim, identify as a non-Muslim, eat pork, you know, chorizo, drink the wine, whatever he wanted to do. And yet, in the end, the message is he could not leave this dark religion that had some kind of inherent effect on him, and it promoted or it brought back the stereotypes, the violence, the anti-woman, the anti-American, the disloyal person. And I think that especially in this time where we are hearing about these kind of things and where hate is being mainstreamed, it really is troubling.
Yeah, I mean, we saw his development throughout the performance, where he worked so hard to move past this part of his past, and regardless, ending up you know, embodying many of the things that he so harshly criticized. So
it's like he, first that he would have to do that to get away from this terrible religion, and then when he does it, he's still not able to, that there's something inherently bad or evil there. And that's my concern about the message that's being put forward.
Well, maybe now's a great time then to kind of bridge into the politics part. Obviously, yesterday, who watched the inauguration? Just a few of you? Okay. And then...
Purposely.
and who followed the march? Yeah, and the marches today and yesterday.
Yeah.
I think, you know, it's no secret that this election brought out some divisiveness in our culture. Elections tend to do that. It felt, though, and I'm speaking just my opinion, that it was much more just ugly this time around. And all these different groups of people feeling threatened in their own way based on their identity. So, you know, I guess just hearing from, you know, each of the people in the organizations that you work with, you know, among you all, just looking ahead to 2017, what are some of a couple of adjectives, I guess, to describe what those, you know, the people that you work with are feeling looking ahead to this new administration?
She does.
Well, first of all, I want to react to this. I think only white people oftentimes are ones who talk about the damage associated with identity politics. I cannot separate my physical identity from everything that it means to be an African-American person. And all of the baggage, historical trauma, everything associated with being a black person, I could not get away from that if I wanted to. So I don't use my identity as a political issue. It is what it is. And I think Amir's problem, his basic character flaw was trying to escape from what he was. And looking at, through no fault of his own, having internalized all of these negative messages to the extent that he started to believe all of those bad things about himself, and in doing so, contributed to the perversion of Islam that was put upon him. So I just think that if you are a person of color, an ethnic minority, whatever you want to do to define what it is to be black or brown or gay or straight or anything like that, that if you don't embrace what you are and understand everything that goes into the creation of what you are, it will not turn out well for you.
So I think I might disagree a little bit. So I live sort of embedded in, you know, the vast right-wing conspiracy, but the part that Mark Belling would call sort of the egghead wing. And we were flabbergasted by this election cycle because the conversation began to be about something that we didn't really particularly want to talk about. That the nomination of the party who, you know, normally advances the ideas that, you know, we believe in limited government, individual liberty, free markets, at least that's what I believe in. It began, there was this undertone of sort of a tribalism that was sort of set itself against the tribalism that was perceived on the part of the Democrats. And that's a conversation that we didn't want to have. We wanted to have a conversation about policy and not about identity. And I think there's a danger in sort of saying that that I as an individual must in some sense be who I was born to be. I mean, in my own view, and I kind of agree in a way that that it was kind of an odd sort of twist at the end of the play, that that Amir couldn't leave his, you know, religion, however you feel about it. Amir ought to be able to leave his religion if he wants to be. He ought to be whoever Amir wants to be. And I think part of the problem is that his friends wouldn't let him be that. And I think that I think that's unfortunate. And so my own view going forward is I hope that the political conversation becomes something about other than the sort of the competing camps that we've placed ourselves in.
Well, your question was about what our organizations are working on. So our kind of, if you've seen any of the rally signs, dissent is patriotic. We've been saying that for 100 years almost. We're saying it a lot. You know, don't be stupid, don't break the law, don't be violent, but we have a First Amendment for a reason, and it's not because we all want to talk about how much we love each other. The First Amendment was specifically designed to protect speech against the government. That's what it's there for. So you're going to hear a lot of dissent is patriotic. We also are trying very hard to be inclusive with the We the People message. And that really does mean everybody. And one of the posters we have is, you know, the whole background of it is all these different political identities, if you want to call it that. But really, what it is, it ends up being just one big, you know, clump, because that's kind of what it is. If we all try to, you know, that's the whole thing about democracy, is all of us have so many identities and they overlap and they sometimes clash, but the way it's supposed to work is you get the government you voted in, and the people who don't agree are allowed to speak against that government. And it happens that way all the time. It's always happened that way. It's not gonna stop now. But do it the right way. Your elected officials are supposed to listen to you. They don't always, obviously, but that doesn't mean you should stop talking to them. So you'll be hearing a lot from us about reminding you what your job in this great democracy is, and your job is to continue to share your opinion with the people who are there to represent you.
On the topic of the election, I don't think it's a secret for anyone who knows me. I publicly supported President Trump.
Oh, wait, I did.
And some people still love me, but some people can't stand me.
That is a true
for
statement.
That reason alone. And people in the LGBT community were protesting me for supporting Donald Trump, thinking now I'm a racist. Right now I'm anti-LGBT, and now because of a very, very small but unfortunately vocal minority who is using this election as an excuse to bring out the worst in themselves and trying to bring out the worst in the rest of society, and people are picking up on it in the media, all of a sudden now every Republican is a racist or a sexist or a bigot. And so to me, what I would love to see is, why don't we go back to the 90% that we all agree on, and let's move those agendas forward, move those issues forward, and continue to dialogue on the things that we disagree.
And before I pass this on to Othman, this is one of the things that drives me bananas, is we've decided that we can't work together on anything, right? The left and the right, or the Democrats and the Republicans, or however you want to divide it up. Find something, anything, one thing. And I'm talking about the Wisconsin State Legislature right now. Find one bipartisan thing you can do, for the love of God, anything.
Right.
And let's prove that it's good, good, good. Let's prove that we can get one little thing done, and then maybe we can get two little things done, and maybe we can get a big thing done. We've got to do this, you guys, and they're not going to do it unless they hear from you. Tell them to pick a thing and do it, and you will support them.
We will talk much more about that as we conclude, but I want to give you a chance to weigh in.
Sure, thank you. Again, I don't disagree. You know, Andy, and we forgive you as well. let me tell you what my concern is. In my community, there's obviously a great deal of uncertainty. But let me tell you where some of those concerns actually come from. Remember that one of the major proponents of the birther movement was Donald Trump. And I think that most people may not have taken that, you know, the whole issue like Muslims have taken it, because what was said was, you are a Muslim. And the word Muslim was taken as an epithet. And the way that we took it was he called him a Muslim because he couldn't call him the N-word. Okay? I mean, it was like they wanted to put him down. And when we're saying we want to make America great again, it's because he made it so bad. And America is terrible. And when he says that Muslims were cheering 9/11 in New Jersey, it's a big lie. That the journalists, any journalist was out there and our security agency said this didn't happen, and yet he says that, that's our concern. Here's a guy who's lying blatantly, and yet he's getting away with it. Throughout my history, we could go back to the quotes that I've made over the years. I've actually voted for Democrat and Republican, not recently. Again, I'm sorry to say, because I believe that the Republicans began to be hijacked by those who were more on the extreme. I personally don't believe Trump is a diehard Republican. I believe he's an opportunist. And I think that I'm more concerned about some of the people he's surrounded by than I am about Donald Trump himself. I'll leave it at that for now.
Thank you. We only have 5 minutes remaining, and I do want to get... Potato, right. I do want to get into something, just a few words that President Trump said yesterday during his address. And I just want to get kind of your reactions to these words. Because there was much talk going into the inauguration from the pundits and the commentators about, will he only focus on I alone can fix this, where's the we going to happen? And there wasn't a ton of that in the speech, but there was some mention for once of unity towards the end. In fact, he said, when you open your heart to patriotism, there's no room for prejudice. We must speak our minds openly, debate disagreements honestly, but always pursue solidarity. And finally, when America is united, America is totally unstoppable. So I guess just what do you make of that statement and those statements that he said during the speech? Is that something that we're going to see embodied in our politics? Is there going to be a change in the rhetoric, in the policy? What do you make of those comments?
Look, he is an opportunist, right? He's got the power in his tweets to have a direct line from his mouth to all of our ears, and the media has given him that. The first president, word for word, with no retranslation, going straight into our living rooms and into our cell phones. So my hope is he uses that power for good. To be determined, but I certainly hope I didn't make a huge mistake.
I have to admit, I wound up voting for Trump too, but with a great deal of trepidation. Because I didn't really have, I kept joking that my team didn't make the playoffs this year. I think that, yeah, he emphasized unity. I think that, you know, Trump is at heart a nationalist. I think that the concern that people have that, you know, Trump is a racist or a sexist or a bigot, I think that that's overstated. My notion of Trump is that he is he's sort of a nationalist. And to be a nationalist in America is a little bit different than being a nationalist in European countries, because our national identity, notwithstanding, you know, the difficult history we have, but our national identity at bottom is really not about ethnicity. And so if he can somehow appeal to the better of our nature, he may get some good things done. But I think, I agree, it remains to be seen in a way that I think is has not characterized our recent presidential elections. I mean, we sort of knew what George W. Bush was going to do. We sort of knew what Barack Obama was going to do. I haven't the slightest idea what Donald Trump is going to do.
So cautious kind of optimism I'm hearing, but still,
for me, yeah.
But still kind of trepidation in your voice here. What about you? Are you sold?
Well, first of all, when you open your heart to patriotism, there's no room for prejudice. He did not write that.
No, that.
I have more.
When America, he did not write that. I don't think he has those, I don't think he has that sentiment in his body. I think, though, from an organizational perspective, you know, the things that the YWCA, the work that we focus on is helping people get, you know, complete their high school education so they can get a job. So I'm hoping that he is telling the truth when he talks about everything he's going to do to bring jobs back. I'm going to be looking for that. I have accepted the fact that he is POTUS 45, and I am going to be one of those people who really looks to hold him to account for all of these outrageous promises he's making. I'm concerned about what's going to happen to replace the Affordable Care Act, which I think even 44 said was not perfect and could use some work, but to pull the rug out from under over 20 million people that depend on it, I'm concerned about that. But I do not believe he said that. I think the fact that we really don't know what he may or may not do is probably the scariest thing about his.
That uncertainty, and you kind of echoed that as well. So as we wrap up, just a few minutes left here, let me just ask you, you know, what's your take on these words that Trump said yesterday? And
you look at me?
Yes, or the two of you. And
Kristin, you can go first.
Thanks, Othman. we all know each other, you guys. I mean, it wasn't set up that way on purpose, but we kind of do. What was the question? What do
just,
I think?
Yeah, I mean, hearing these words yesterday about
first
this,
of all,
this
I,
kind of patriotism.
It would be not, those were nice words. I agree with Paula. He did not write those. I think he probably, I know there was a speech on the teleprompter. I think he started it, and then he always does, and then he goes off script, and then he tries to pull himself back toward the end. So he did that thing. I do think that a huge challenge we all have, all of us, is the unpredictability. He's never held office. He said lots of crazy things. The ACLU took his crazy stuff seriously because we had to plan. We did the same thing with Hillary Clinton. You can find the Trump memos and the Clinton memos online. We tried to look at the things he actually said as if they were real policy decisions, so we will be prepared. And by the way, that thing about Muslim men being asked to come and visit the FBI was a real thing. 13,000 Muslims were deported in the first year after 9/11. We're very concerned that these meetings, please just come down and have a chat with us, are gonna start again. I hope they don't, I hope we're wrong. My only real hope is that the voice we still have with the, let's call them establishment Republicans, and I'm counting the leadership in that, will somehow give them enough power to sway him if he's about to go off the rails. Because let's remember, this guy loves to be adored. That's what this was really all about, this entire race. That's why he said crazy stuff, and the louder the crowd cheered, the more he said crazy stuff. So if we can get him to feel that if he does something that the establishment wants him to do and that maybe the people don't hate terribly, that that's a good thing and that it makes him feel like we're happy with his performance, maybe that'll work. But in the meantime, we have a constitution. And we're gonna sit here and continue to defend the Constitution and the people who live under it. And if that means we're suing him constantly, we're suing him constantly. We filed a Freedom of Information Act yesterday at noon, asking for the information about his conflicts overseas. They're supposed to give them to us.
With the last 60 seconds here, I do wanna ask you, Othman, about we did talk about the things that Trump said in, you know, about unity in the speech, but I guess one thing that I was looking for was more of a direct reference to some of the groups that felt so marginalized, especially Islam in light of the Muslims, especially in light of the work we saw today. Really, the only mention that it was made of Islam was wiping out radical terrorism from the face of the earth. So Just what's your reaction to that, you know, as a Muslim activist looking out to this next administration?
I mean, I was disappointed. I don't think it was just Muslims. I think most groups felt that he would be very open and say, look, you know, we're all one, let's get together, let's figure things out. This issue of the patriotism, if I could go back to that, I mean, it's been patriotism and nationalism that has actually been the scourge of most of our world when people use it as a basis for putting down others. I mean, Nazi Germany, those who were lynching African Americans here thought they were patriotic, interning the Japanese that thought they were patriotic. I'm worried about those who pursue extreme patriotism, extreme nationalism or patriotism. I am a proud American. I think we should also all be proud Americans, and I believe and strongly support Kristin with regards to the issue of the Constitution. I mean, I'm an attorney. I swore an oath to uphold the Constitution. The Constitution is much bigger than the president, especially President Trump.
Yeah.
Thank you all. I think that is a great place to end. Thank you all for sticking around today and enjoying this panel and enjoying the show. Big thanks to the Milwaukee Rep for hosting this conversation. My name is Nate Imig with 88.9 Radio Milwaukee, and one more time for our panel.